Good morning. Today I'm going to talk to you about isoprene NO3 chemistry and focusing on the RO2 plus HO2 pathway. And specifically a newly identified product called isoprene nitrooxyhydroxyepoxide, abbreviated as INHE, and shown here pictorially on the right. So we know that NO3 chemistry is important in the atmosphere because we detect it occurring in the field. So both in the ZOAS 2013 field campaigns and the BearPax 2009 field campaigns, we've detected these products. And they've also been detected in other studies as well. And these nitrates form when the sun sets because NO3 is readily photolyzed during the day. And so I've shown here results from the SOAS 2013 field campaign. And you can see in blue the nitrooxyhydroxyepoxide and in red the carbonyl nitrate both increase at night. And that showed in the shaded region. And the hydroxy nitrate, it's a little unclear just looking at the field study results because it's also a product from OH oxidation of isoprene. So you can see that this chemistry is relevant during SOAS and in the field. This chemistry is important to study because it has a very high nitrate yield. Model studies predict that 40 to 50% of all isoprene-derived nitrates are from NO3 chemistry. And these nitrates influence both NOx and ozone levels in both in local and distant environments, and they also generate secondary organic aerosol. The Brown et al. 2009 field study looked at isoprene specifically, and the Rollins 2012 study looked at just NO3 chemistry in a more general sense, and that's what's plotted on the left. And they saw that particulate nitrates increased and organic aerosol increased at night. And that the ratio between also increased. So this indicates that nitrates forming from NO3 chemistry are going into the particle phase. So understanding the exact chemistry occurring in the gas phase is necessary to really understand what's going into the aerosol. So a lot of chamber studies have been done on isoprene NO3 chemistry. I've put a couple of the more recent studies at the bottom. And I'm just going to go through the chemistry that's known. Isoprene reacts with NO3 to form a peroxy radical. And then it will react with NO or NO3 to form an alkoxy radical, or it'll react with RO2 to form two alkoxy radicals, or a hydroxynitrate and a carbonyl nitrate. And the RO2-RO2 pathways and the RO2 plus NO3 pathways have been really well studied in chamber studies, but less has been focused on the RO2 plus HO2 pathway. But it was the non-dominant pathway in some of these chamber studies, so we can still tell that nitrooxyhydroperoxide forms from this pathway. And the Rollins 2009 and Kwan 2012 paper saw OH in their system, so they predicted that the RO2 plus HO2 pathway would also generate OH. So what we want to do is run chamber studies to specifically look at the RO2 plus HO2 pathway and determine what the gas phase products are. And then once we do this, we want to generate OH in the chamber so that we can see if OH will react with the hydroperoxide, abbreviated as INP, to form an epoxide, abbreviated as INHE. And this is relevant in the atmosphere because, as we saw from the SOAS results, all of the nitrates that are formed from isoprene NO3 chemistry will not go away during the night. And then when the sun rises, their dominant fate will be to react with OH. So, and this is very similar chemistry to what happens with isopu and iepox in the OH isoprene oxidation system. And if we form this compound, we want to see whether it's uptaken into different types of aerosol, because we expect it to be an important precursor to SOA, just like iepox is. So to do this, we ran several chamber experiments, both in the 24-meter-cubed bag Teflon chamber at Caltech and also a 1-meter-cubed Teflon chamber. And we used chemical ionization mass spectrometry to look at the gas phase species using CF3- as a reagent ion. And the key to this study is really being able to have NO3 and HO2 present in the study, so we focus on the RO2 plus HO2 pathways rather than the RO2 plus RO2 pathway, which is very common with NO3 chemistry. And so to do this, we injected between 2 to 4 ppm of formaldehyde into the chamber. And formaldehyde will react with NO3 to form HO2. And so you have this really nice coupled system where whenever you have NO3 present in the chamber, you also have HO2 around. And then once we had generated the main nitrates, we turned on lights to generate OH to see the decomposition products and to form the epoxide. Then we turned off lights, let things stabilize, and then injected various seed particles to understand the uptake potential of the epoxide. So the main nitrates forming in the gas phase were exactly what was expected. The same chemistry is occurring that I showed you in the slide before. The key to this study, though, is being able to determine the difference between the nitrooxyhydroxyepoxide and the nitrate hydroxyepoxide, because they say come out at the same mass on our instrument. So we need a way to actually differentiate between these two compounds. So to do this, we use the GC-TOF-SIMS technique. And I'm just going to quickly go over what this technique is. What we have basically is a GC, and we cold trap the sample, gas phase species onto this GC. Then we ramp the temperature slowly, and we detect what elutes off and at what time using the TOF-SIMS. So we get these really nice chromatograms to separate isobaric species. So here are the chromatograms for the mass MDZ negative 248, which is the mass that both the hydroperoxides and the epoxides come out at. And I plotted here the chromatograms for over the course of the experiment. The blue and the red are before lights on, and the magenta and the cyan are after lights on. And what we found, and you can see that these chromatograms change over the course of the experiment. It's hard to see just looking at that, so I also integrated the areas and made the figure on the right, assuming the same sensitivity for all of the compounds. And what you can see is that the hydroperoxides go up mostly in the dark phase, and then they'll decrease when we turn on lights. And the epoxides largely grow in when we turn on lights. And then what was really nice about these chromatograms is that we could also really differentiate what the products of the RO2 plus HO2 pathway were in the gas phase. And it's been traditionally assumed that the RO2 plus HO2 reaction will just form the hydroperoxide, which is pathway R1. But carbonyl peroxy radicals have been shown to react with HO2 to form a variety of products, all of the pathways, R1 to R5. There's been no direct or theoretical studies looking at the nitrate peroxy radicals specifically, but both Rollins' 2009 paper and Kwan 2012 paper suggested that they saw OH from this chemistry happening. And we see the exact same thing, but our results are more exaggerated because we're looking at just the RO2 plus HO2 pathway specifically. So when we inject isoprene into the chamber, we see a rapid increase of isopoo, which is is formed from OH reacting with isoprene and then also reacting with HO2. And so we can use this to constrain the amount of OH that's forming from this pathway, although it is an upper limit because there is possibility of OH forming from other pathways as well. And from this, we get that about a little less than half of the RO2 plus HO2 is forming OH and MBK and a carbonyl nitrate, and then a little bit more than half is forming the nitrooxyhydroperoxide and the and then more of it is in the delta state rather than the beta state. And then this is the RO2 distribution. So we can use the products that we see from the RO2 plus HO2 chemistry to back calculate what the RO2 distribution is. And I state this for a light RO2 lifetime of about 30 seconds, which is what the RO2 lifetime in this study was. But we don't know right now whether the RO2 distribution will be affected by the RO2 lifetime. It's been shown by theoretical work by Peters et al. That for the OH system, the RO2 distribution is affected by RO2 lifetime. So Dr. Henrik Kjærgaard of the University of Copenhagen is going to calculate theoretical studies for us. But right now, I don't have these results. But at an RO2 lifetime about 30 seconds, we see that dominantly the NO3 adds on to the C1 carbon of isoprene rather than the C4 carbon, and that mostly we're forming the delta RO2 species rather than the betas. And then the nitrates have an even higher delta to beta ratio because many of the betas will react with HO2 and then decompose rather than forming nitrates. So you have an even higher representation of the deltas in the nitrates that are formed. And then I'm showing the decomposition products for when we turned on lights and generated OH in the chamber. This is basically looking, so we generate all the nitrates and then turn on lights, so it's a sum of all the nitrates that we formed in their decomposition products. But even so, we see a really large yield of propanone nitrate. And this is to be expected because mostly we're forming the C1 delta nitrates. And so this might be able to be used as a tracer in the field for understanding when this chemistry is going on. But it's really hard to predict the exact products because there's large uncertainties in each of the isomers' reactions with OH and ozone, and also the exact products. So definitely understanding this later generation chemistry needs to happen to really be able to predict what's going on. And then I also wanted to show how the epoxide that we generated in this study, INHE, was uptaken into aerosol. And so we ran several repetitive experiments where we injected different Z-types at the end of the experiment. And the black line represents when we injected acidified seed. And just like other epoxides, like IEPOX, when we injected acidic seed into the chamber, which is shown by the brown line, we saw a drastic decrease in the signal in the gas phase and a corresponding increase on the aerosol, the AMS, of total organic. We also tried dry ammonium sulfate seed and humid ammonium hydrated ammonium sulfate seed. Unfortunately, it was hard to constrain whether the reason for the higher total organic signal on the AMS in the hydrated case was actually from INHE or if it was from something from other chemistry going on. So really, we need to synthesize these compounds to really constrain the aerosol uptake. Then here are my conclusions and the main acknowledgments, and I'll let you read them. And then if you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Just a general comment. It's amazing how much detail you guys can get from this really complex chemistry. Questions? Yes.
A few questions would be, before you go into the SEMS, how do you get rid of the carrier gas? And the other question, I actually have several, but I'll ask three. The other question is, so when you eat a nitrate, it decomposes, and of course the GC operates by eating the column.
So, so we actually calculate the transmission based on, so we know how much is in the bag, and then we calculate, sum all of the areas, and then calculate the transmission. So through different, the 1 meter column, we actually have 100% transmission for the nitrates. So we can actually quantify that we're not losing anything. And then we also have standards, not for the compound specifically in this work, but we have standards for the hydroxynitrates, so that also helps us constrain what's going on. And then you asked about the carrier gas, we use nitrogen.
How do you get rid of it before it goes in the sim?
Oh, get rid of the nitrogen? Sorry, I'm not understanding. So we trap the species on, we cold trap the species on the GC column. And then as we're warming the column, we send nitrogen through, not so it's like clean nitrogen, so we only have what's coming off of the product, the column going into the SIMS. Does that make sense? So we have standards for the hydroxynitrates. So yes, and then we're assuming that the sensitivity for our instrument is similar for the other nitrates, but that's not necessarily the case. We'll really need standards to quantify anything. But the products that I'm showing here I'm not using the SIM sensitivities to constrain how much nitroxyhydroxyepoxide, for example, is being produced. I'm using the OH measurement to constrain this. And that's being constrained by the ISOPU, which we do have standards for and is good sensitivity for our SIMS.
There's one more question, Danielle.
Does nitrate provide a permanent sink for NOx and return NOx to the
It really depends probably on what the decomposition products are. I mean, a lot of them are going, it seems, to the propanone nitrate, and then that has a higher lifetime in the atmosphere. So it really constraining what the later generation chemistry is for these products is going to tell that more specifically. Largely, when these main nitrates that are forming are going to react with OH during the daytime, so it really depends on what the decomposition products exactly are. Yeah.
Okay, well, thanks again.
Oh, thank you.